Hello friends, today we are going to discuss the topic thyristors. In that we are going to focus on the silicon control rectifiers, its applications and the GTO. Up till now we have focused on the power devices like power BJT, power MOSFET, IGBT. IGBT which is the combination of physical combination of the power MOSFET and the power BJTs. Now, today we are going to focus on the topic thyristors. Now, what do you mean by thyristors? Thyristors are nothing but we can say these are the four layer devices. Now, what do you mean by four layer device? Like in the introductory part, what we have seen, diode is a two layer device. There is only PN structure is there. Transistors are the three layer devices, that is PNP or NPN combination is there. Now these thyristors are called as four layer devices. That means it is having four layers of the semiconductor materials. So sometimes we can call it as PNPN structure. That is why these thyristors are also called as four layer devices. Now let us see what are these. So these thyristors are the family of solid state devices. So thyristor is, it is a complete family consisting of various devices, power devices, and it consists of SCR, that is a silicon control rectifier, DIAC, that is a diode on AC, TRIAC, triode on AC, or GTO, that is gate turn off thyristors. Again, there are various types related to the SCR are also there. Now, these thyristors, they are operated as a bistable switches that are either working in non-conducting or the conducting state. So, this is very important point that these are operated as a bistable switches and these are either working in non-conducting and the conducting states. Now these traditional thyristors are designed without gate control turn-off capability. Now what do you mean by this gate turn-off turn-on capability? That we will see when we are going to focus on the SCR. So, this gate control turn-off capability in which the thyristor can come from the conducting state to the non-conducting state when only anode current falls below the holding current. So, these are all the things related to the VI characteristics of the thyristors that we have to focus on. While GTO, it is the only type of the thyristor family, it is gate controlled turn-off capability. It is having the gate controlled turn-off capability. Now the important thing is these thyristors are basically divided into two parts. The first one is unidirectional thyristor. Now what do you mean by unidirectional thyristors? Sometimes unidirectional thyristors are called as the current is flowing in the first quadrant only. Like if you see this VI characteristics, so for the unidirectional thyristors we are getting the VI characteristics in the first quadrant only. So the current is flowing in the first quadrant. So these are called as unidirectional thyristors where the current is flowing in one direction only, that is say from anode to cathode. So these are called as unidirectional thyristors. So what is the best example for the unidirectional thyristor is SCR, that is silicon control rectifier, sometimes SUS or LASCR. So what is SUS, LASCR? SUS is the silicon unilateral switch. This is working as a switch. LASCR, it is nothing but the light activated SCR. So, unidirectional thyristors, in which the current flows in the one directional only, that are called as unidirectional thyristors. The second type for the thyristor is bidirectional thyristors. Now, what do you mean by bidirectional thyristors? In the bidirectional thyristors, we are getting the VI characteristics in the both quadrant, that is first quadrant and the second quadrant, the characteristics are similar like this. So, as we can see here, in the both the quadrant, we are getting the same characteristics. That means we can say in the bidirectional thyristors, the current is flowing in both direction, that is in first quadrant and the second quadrant. And now the best example related to the bidirectional thyristor is a dyac and the triac. So these dyac and triac are called as bidirectional devices because in that the current is flowing from terminal 1 to terminal 2 as well as from terminal 2 to terminal 1. In both the direction there is flow of current. So that is why these are called as bidirectional thyristors. And these kind of VI characteristics graph variation we are getting in the unidirectional and the bidirectional thyristors. In unidirectional, we are getting the current in the first quadrant only. In bidirectional, we are getting the current characteristics in both directions. Now, let us focus on the silicon control rectifier. Now, this silicon control rectifier, it is the primary member of the thyristor family. Sometimes a silicon control rectifier is also called as thyristor only. So, we should not get confused with that. Thyristor, it is a complete solid state device family in which various devices, power devices are there, but silicon control rectifiers are also called as thyristors. So, this silicon control rectifier, it is a 4-layer PNPN structure. Now, let us see what is it. So, in this, what we can see, this is the symbolic representation of SCR or silicon control rectifier, and this is how it is look physically. So, silicon control rectifier, it is having three terminals, anode, cathode and the gate. So, gate is near to the cathode terminal. So, anode is positive, cathode is negative terminals, and gate is connected to the near to the cathode terminal. So, this is silicon control rectifier, and this is how the physical structure of the silicon rectifier is looking. So, there are three terminals, cathode, anode and the gate. So, this is BT151 silicon control rectifier, it is showing here. Now, what is a silicon control rectifier? It is basically a switching device for high voltage and the high current applications. If we want the voltage level from say 100 volt to some 1000 volt and the current rating should be high, silicon control rectifiers are the best examples for the switching devices for which the high voltage and the high current operations are needed. Now, the best thing in the silicon control rectifier, that is they are using very low power for the control, because in the very first lecture what we have seen that power electronics is dealing with the electronics, power and the control. So, control is very much important, and in the name only there is a silicon controlled rectifier. So, why this is called as a silicon control rectifier? Because first of all, this is a silicon structure, that is a semiconductor material which is used for this device is silicon. Then it is control rectifier, it is shown over here. Now, why it is called as control rectifier? Because whenever AC is converted into DC, then this is called as rectification. So, whenever the rectification is done, it should be the control rectification. We have to control the phase angle for that rectification. So, these are called as silicon control rectifier, which controls the rectification of the power. So for the rectification of the power, it uses very low power for the control. So that is why these are called as silicon controlled rectifiers. Now whenever we have seen the thyristor classification, that is unidirectional and the bidirectional thyristors, what we have seen, that in the unidirectional thyristor, current flows in only one direction. So this is the best example for the unidirectional thyristors. In these, it conducts in the forward direction only. So these silicon controlled rectifiers are conducting in the forward direction only. So let us see the structure of this SCR. So what we have seen earlier, that BJT is the combination of two diodes. When PN and NP diodes are connected with each other, we are getting the BJT. But now the important point to be noticed over here, that whenever we are pairing of the BJT or they are tightly coupled, there is a formation of silicon controlled rectifier. That means we can say when two BJTs are connected, silicon controlled rectifier is formed, because this is four layer structure, that is PNPN. So if it is four layer structure, we can see this is PNP is forming the one transistor, and NPN it is forming the another transistor. So from this PNPN structure, we can say that it is a tightly coupled pair of the two BJTs, that is PNP and NPN. Now whenever we are going to focus on the characteristics of the SCR, this SCR is having three states, that is a reverse blocking mode, forward blocking mode, and the forward conducting mode. Now here we can see from these pictures, it is clear that silicon controlled rectifiers, it is what? The PNPN structure, that is the combination of two diodes over here. So let us see in that, this is PNP and this gate is connected near to the cathode over here. So symbolically, when these two transistors are connected, let's see, this is the PNP transistor and this is NPN transistor. So here it is considered as anode and this is considered as cathode terminal and this is gate. So gate is connected to the collector of the PNP transistor to the base of NPN transistor, and it is near to the cathode terminal, that is emitter terminal of the NPN transistor, it is called as cathode, whereas emitter terminal of the PNP transistor is called as anode. And the gate, it is connected to the collector of the PNP transistor and base of the NPN transistor. So this is how, when one PNP and another NPN transistors are tightly coupled with each other, there is a formation of SCROs there. Now let us focus on the VI characteristics of the SCR. So this graph is showing us the VI characteristics of the SCI. Now what I told you, this is the unidirectional device. Now if it is a unidirectional device, we can see that current is flowing in the forward direction only. So if the current is flowing in the forward direction, we can consider this is VAK, that is anode to cathode voltage, and this is IAK, that is anode current. Okay, so in this, what is happening? We can see the different regions in this first quadrant and the last quadrant, that is third quadrant. So what is happening over here? So whenever the SCR is to be turned on, the gate should be triggered, because it is having how many terminals? Three terminals it is having. This is say anode, this is cathode, and near to this, there is a gate terminal. So what is the use of this gate terminal over here? No doubt the current is flowing from anode to cathode, that is anode current. But why the gate terminal is provided over here? That in this SCR, whenever we are giving the pulse or the current to the gate terminal, then only the current is flowing through anode to cathode. So in this, how the current is flowing? That in the PNP structure, in this PNP structure, what we can see, there are three terminals, anode, cathode and the gate. Whenever we have seen the diode, in the diode the current is flowing from anode to cathode. Now here the gate terminal is provided over here. Now what is the use of this gate terminal? So this gate terminal is responsible for making your SCR on. So how to use this gate terminal for making the SCR on? That when the voltage is supplied between anode to cathode and gate is open, when the gate is open, now because this gate is connected to the base of NPN transistors. Now what we have seen in the transistor, that the base current is very much important for the emitter current and the collector current. So here, if suppose we are not giving the any gate supply and we are just applying the voltage between anode to cathode, what is happening? In between this, the emitter current is flowing from the PNP transistor, and that current is divided into the, this is the base current and it is going to the collector of the NPN transistor. Now this current, that is this gate terminal, we are not giving any kind of the supply. What will happen? If we are not getting any supply, then this current which is coming from the anode terminal, it is not responsible for making this anode current to flow from PNP transistor to the NPN transistor. So to make this junction, that is, this is the, we can say this is VBE junction for the NPN transistor. So this gate junction or gate terminal is responsible for making this VBE junction of the NPN transistor forward bias, because what we have seen, that whenever the transistor is to be turned on, the VBE junction to be forward bias. And VCB junction should be reverse bias. So this condition should be satisfied. So what is happening here? We are giving the emitter current over here. So emitter current is going to the collector of the PNP transistor. But for the NPN transistor, this VBE terminal, or we can say this VBE junction, is not forward bias state. So when the VBE junction of the NPN transistor will get forward bias, then only the current can be flow through the NPN transistor. That means anyway we have to give the gate supply to the this thyristor, then only the thyristor or the SCR will be on. So in the VI characteristics of this SCR, what we can see here is, this is showing us the graph between VAK, that is anode to cathode voltage, to the anode to cathode current over here. So what is happening here? Now this portion is giving us the values of the current and the IG. So here IG plays the important role for the flow of anode current. So in the VI characteristics of this silicon control rectifier, we are just focusing on this first quadrant first. In the first quadrant, what you can see, there is a breakover voltage over here, that is VBO. This is gate triggered. Now why gate triggered is on? This is conduction state. That means we have to give the gate supply for the flow of the anode current. Then this portion is called as off state forward voltage blocking, forward current, this is forward bias. Now let us see one by one, what do you mean by the different terminologies related with the VI characteristics of this SCR. So first terminology, it is the breakover voltage. Now, what do you mean by breakover voltage? This breakover voltage is also called as a forward breakover voltage. So, this is sometimes called as a forward breakover voltage. Now, so what is this breakover voltage? This is the minimum forward voltage with the gate open that the SCR starts conducting. Now, for this breakover voltage, what is happening? This is the minimum forward voltage. So, definitely to make the device on, we need the forward current, and for that forward current, we need the forward voltage. So, this breakover voltage is the minimum forward voltage or the minimum forward potential with gate open where the SCR starts conducting. So, in other words, what we can say, the point where SCR is turned on, it is called as breakover voltage, or the voltage at which SCR is start conducting, or the conduction state is taking place, that voltage is called as breakover voltage. Sometimes it is called as VBO. So, here what we can see, this is called as VBO because up till now you can see here there is a minimum current over here, and after that when this voltage is dropping out here. So, from this the voltage is dropping out and there is this sudden increase in the current. So, this is called as knee voltage or the breakover voltage for that. So, for the SCR, the breakover voltage is sometimes 100 volts. Why we are taking this example for the 100 volt, the breakover voltage should be 100 volt for the SCR because it can block a forward voltage until the supply is less than 100 volt. So, for the less than 100 volt, it can block the forward voltage. So, when it reaches to the 100 volt, after that, after reaching this point to the point of 100 volt, there is sudden decrease in the, or there is sudden drop in the voltages and the current starts to increase. So, 100 volt, it is the, we can say, breakover voltage of SCR. When it exits the 100 volt, the current starts to increase over there. So, this is called as breakover voltage. Now, the second terminology which is related with the SCR characteristics curve, it is called as a peak reverse voltage. So, in the reverse bias condition, you can see over here in the third quadrant, there is a reverse voltage blocking and reverse bias, reverse breakdown voltage is there. So, what is a peak reverse voltage? So, peak reverse voltage, it is the maximum reverse voltage that can be applied to the SCR without conducting in the reverse direction. So, what is peak reverse voltage? First of all, we should know what is fixed reverse voltage. So, this peak reverse voltage, it is the maximum reverse voltage that can be applied to the SCR without conducting in the reverse direction. That means SCR, it is not conducting in the reverse direction, but what is happening? It can be applied to the SCR. So, that is called as peak reverse voltage. Now, very important points are to be considered over here, that this current, so this anode current which is flowing from this point to this point is divided into two parts, that is holding current and the latching current. Now, what do you mean by this holding current? Holding current is nothing but the maximum anode current over here. So, this is the holding current which can be shown over here. So, this is maximum anode current. Now, this holding current is when the gate is being open. So, when the gate is being open, at which the SCR is turned off from on condition, that is called as holding current. So, holding current is, it is referred to when the SCR, it is in the conduction state and with gate open, at which the SCR is turned off from on condition. So, when the current is coming below the holding current, the SCR is turned off. So, what is the important condition for the SCR to be turned off? That current should be below, or current should fall down from this holding current, then only the SCR will get off. So, in this, what is happening? We have seen how the SCR is being turned on. So, SCR, to make the SCR on, it is very much required that it should be triggered with the gate pulse. So whenever we are giving the gate supply, the SCR is turning on. Now in this holding current, what we have seen, to make the SCR off, the current comes below the holding current and then the SCR will be turning off. That means what we are going to see is the SCR cannot be turned off by the removing the gate voltage. That means after removing the gate voltage, the SCR is not turning off. So we require the external commutation circuit. Commutation means the process for which the SCR is being off. So that is called as commutation process. So the commutation circuitry we require to make the SCR off. The only way to turn off the SCR or open the SCR is to reduce the supply voltage to almost zero. So when we are reducing that supply voltage to the almost zero, the SCR is turned off, and at which the internal resistance comes out of the saturation and opens the SCR. So what is happening for the holding current over here? That in the holding current, when the current is falling below the holding current, SCR goes into the off state. But it is not the necessary condition that we have to apply some gate voltage over there. We have to apply some gate pulse, or we have to remove the gate pulse for making the SCR off. We have to give the gate pulse to turn on the SCR. So this holding current is very much important. Another point which is related to the SCR characteristics, that latching current, sometimes it is called as IL. Now what do you mean by IL? This holding current is denoted by IH. What do you mean by this latching current? Latching current is the current, or it is the point where the current reaches and SCR, it is stable in the on state. So this is called as a latching current. So this latching current, it is responsible for making your SCR in the on state. So this forward current is divided into two parts. We can say latching current and the holding current. What is latching current? Latching current is in which the SCR is kept constant at the on state, and holding current means whenever the current, anode current, is falling below the IH, that is holding current, SCR is turning off. So we require the forward current ratings over here. So these forward current ratings are related to the holding current and the latching current. So what is this rating? These are the maximum anode current that the SCR can be sustained. So these are the forward current ratings which are important for this. Now this is all related to the first quadrant characteristics, or we can say forward bias characteristics of the SCR. Now let us focus on this third quadrant. Now in this third quadrant, what we are going to see is there is a peak reverse voltage. Now what is this peak reverse voltage? So these kind of characteristics we have seen, same we have seen in the diodes only. In the diode, what we have seen, that there is a avalanche breakdown which is done, and due to which there is a forward leakage current is flowing. But in the case of SCR, what we have seen, once the SCR is turned on, it cannot be turned off. So for the turning of the SCR, we require some external commutation circuit. So what will happen if suppose we are not taking out, or we are taking out the current, that is gate current, away from the gate? What is happening? So when the gate supply is removed, so SCR will not get off. So in that case, what is happening? In this PNPN structure, once we have removed the supply from gate, what is happening in this PNPN structure? The SCR, it is still in the conduction mode only. So whenever it is in the conduction mode, the depletion layer is formed between the PNP and NPN transistor, and due to that the current is flowing, and that current is the leakage current, sometimes we called it as, and this is the peak reverse voltage. So this point is called as a peak reverse voltage, from which there is a constant current which is flowing. So this is called as a reverse breakdown voltage. So this is the breakdown voltage from which the current is current, that means that we can say that is leakage current. So this leakage is current is starts flowing. So this peak reverse voltage is very much responsible in the reverse characteristics of the SCR. So what is a reverse voltage blocking? So this much portion is representing as the reverse voltage blocking. So reverse voltage blocking means it is the voltage at which no current is flowing. So once that reverse voltage blocking is reaching to the reverse peak voltage, from that point the leakage current starts to flow. So this is called as a peak reverse voltage, and that is also called as a reverse breakdown voltage from which the current starts to increase. Sometimes it is denoted as VBOR, that is reverse breakdown voltage. So from which the current starts to increase. So that current is the leakage current. So from all the VI characteristics of the SCR, what we have seen in the SCR characteristics curve, what we have seen in the forward bias condition, in the first quadrant the current is flowing, and that current is depending upon the gate supply. When the gate trigger it is on, that is called as conduction state. So in the conduction state, what we have seen, the voltage must reach to the VBO. What is VBO? That is breakover voltage. So when voltage reaches to the breakover voltage, there is a sudden increase in the anode current, and that sudden increase in the anode current is responsible for dropping that anode voltage. So here we can see suddenly there is a dropping of the voltage and the current starts to increase. Now this forward current, sometimes it is called as anode current. This anode current is divided into two parts, that is IL, that is latching current, and the holding current. Latching current, it is the current in which the SCR latches to the conduction mode, so that is called as latching current. Holding current, it is the maximum amount of current in which the gate supply is open, and when the current falls below this holding current, the SCR will be turning off. In the reverse bias condition, what we have seen, that whenever the SCR reaches to the peak reverse voltage, the leakage current starts to increase, and the voltage from the minimum value to the peak reverse voltage, that is called as a reverse voltage blocking in which the current is not flowing. So this is all related to the VI characteristics curve of the SCR. So from this it is proved that the SCR, it is unidirectional device. Now let us focus on the turn off and the turn on characteristics of the SCR. So what we have seen, the important points in the SCR, that to make the SCR turn on, the gate pulse is very much important. When we are giving the gate pulse to the SCR, then only the SCR, it is working in the conduction state. Now for turning off the SCR, there are also some commutation circuits are required. So we have to remove the gate supply so that the SCR comes below the holding current and SCR will be turned on. Now this graph is showing us the turning on and the turning off characteristics of the SCR with respect to time. So there are 3-4 curves we are going to see. So the first graph, it is showing us the VG, that is gate pulse is given. So this gate pulse is constant over there, you can see. Once the gate pulse is given, now here we have to see the variation of the anode current and the anode voltage over here. So this graph is showing us the variation in the anode current and the gate current. Now in this, what we have to see is this is VA. VA is nothing but the anode voltage over here and the gate current. Because anode current is depending upon the gate current only, so first we have to focus on the anode voltage and the gate current. So in this graph, second graph, what we have to see is this current, that is gate current, is reaching to the 90% of IG. So what is 90% of Ig? That means this gate current is increasing from minimum value to the 90%, and after that when it reaches to the maximum, the gate pulse is constant over here. So when the gate pulse is reaches to the 90% of the value, the voltage is also reaching to the 90% of the VA, that is initial anode voltage. So what is VA? VA is the initial anode voltage. So that VA in which the voltage reaches to the 90% of value, when it reaches to the 90% of value, when the gate current reaching to the 90% of the value. So once the gate current is constant over here, what we can see the changes in the anode current? So here you can see the gate current is increasing from 0% value to the 90%, and at that position the anode current is reaching from 0% to the 10% only. Now why there is a difference? Because here the gate current is not constant yet. So to make this anode current maximum, we should reach our gate current to the maximum value. So here when the gate current is increasing from 0 to the 90% of value, anode current value is still 10% only. Now compare these two graphs over here. So by comparing, what we can say, now here the graph of the gate current is constant. This shows the gate current is constant. Now the gate current is constant, then your anode current is increasing from 10% to the 90%. So when the anode current is increasing from 10% to 90%, when the gate current is constant. Now you can see the VA variation here. So what is happening in the VA? The current is, that is anode current, is increasing from 10% to 90%, and there is sudden voltage drop in the anode voltage from 90% to the 10%. So this is proving our graph, VI characteristics graph, that in this is say voltage and this is current. So when the current is increasing, there is sudden decrease in the voltage. So same we are going to see here. So this current is increased from 10% to the 90%, suddenly there is a drop of the voltage, anode voltage, from 90% to the 10%. Now when the anode current is reaching to the maximum value say 100%, this is load current IA, where it is constant. Now here the current is constant over here, so we can say this is the latching state of the SCR. So in the latching state of the SCR is in the conduction mode. Now if suppose we have to decrease the anode current, so by applying the commutation, any kind of commutation, so here say di by dt communication we have applied over here, so the current is falling down, this anode current is falling down, and this is the reverse blocking state, you can say. So when the anode current is falling down, there is no change in the anode voltage over here. So sometimes it is called as this is the recovery or the recombination time. So here it is reverse blocking state. So after removing the gate pulse or the commutation which is given to the gate of the SCR, anode current falls down to the zero value or the minimum value, and there is no anode voltage variation, you can see. But when the anode current is reaching to the reverse blocking state, there is a reverse voltage due to the power circuit, you can see over here. So this portion we are getting due to the process of commutation. That commutation is applied to the gate of the SCR. Now this is all related to the anode current, anode voltage, and the gate voltage. This portion is showing us the forward leakage current. Now what do you mean by forward leakage current? Forward leakage current, it is the current, that is the small amount of current when the small amount of gate current is starts to flow. That means after giving the gate supply, small amount of gate current is flowing, and due to that, whatever the 10% of the current is flowing, that is called as forward leakage current. Now let us focus on this last graph. This is related to the power losses. Now these power losses are done in this portion. Now in this portion, how the power losses are calculated? Because the current is increasing from 10% to the maximum value, and the voltage is dropping from 90% to the 10%. And as we know, power is nothing but the I square R or I into V. So power is voltage into current. So if the current is maximum, definitely there is a power loss. So this power loss is depending upon what? The power loss is depending upon how gradual increase in the anode current, how sudden rise in the anode current. So depending upon that, there is a power loss. So this portion is giving us the power loss. This power is calculated as VAIA, that is anode current and anode voltage. But once the anode current is constant or reaches to the maximum value, there is a steady state operation taking place. So these are the variations of the voltages and the current of the SCR with respect to time. Now let us see what are the applications of the SCR. So very first application of SCR is relay controls. It controls the relays, because the relays are related to the power. So if we want to control the power, we need the SCRs over there. These SCRs are used in the time delay circuits. Now, what do you mean by time delay circuits? Time delay circuits are used where the time lag is important. So, SCR definitely requires the time lag for turning off the SCR current. For that, we require the commutation circuit. So, these SCRs are used in the time delay circuits. SCRs can be used in the regulated power supplies. Now the important application of the SCR is motor control, where we require the alpha is nothing but the firing angle, we can say. So this firing angle is responsible for the phase control of the rectifier. So in the motor control, the SCRs are used. It is used in the chopper circuit. So these chopper circuits are used for the DC to DC converters. Those are called as the chopper circuits. Inverter circuits where AC to DC is converted. Cyclo converters, AC to AC converters are called as cyclo converters, in which the SCRs are used. In the protective circuits, the SCRs are used. So these are the applications of the SCRs. Now let us focus on the GTO, that is a gate turn-off thyristor. So what we have seen, SCR, in SCR, we can make the SCR on, but for making the SCR off, we require the external commutation circuits. That is the kind of thyristor which cannot be turned off by itself. So for making the SCR off, we require the external commutation circuitry. Now another type of thyristor we have to focus on, that is called as a GTO, that is gate turn-off thyristor. So these gate turn-off thyristors, these kind of thyristor devices does not require any external commutation circuits for turning off the device. So let us see what is this gate turn-off thyristor. So first important point is, GTO can be turned on with the positive gate current pulse. So how it can be turned on? With the positive gate current pulse and a turn off with the negative gate current pulse. Its capability to turn off is due to the diversion of PNP collector current by gate, and thus breaking the regenerative feedback effect. So in the PNPN structure, what is happening in the PNPN structure? There is a regenerative feedback which is used for the generation of conduction state. So in the GTO, how we are going to turning off this thyristor? That its capability to turn off is due to the diversion of PNP, that is collector current, which is coming from the PNP transistor to the NPN transistor. So that collector current is coming to the base of the NPN transistor. So we have to divert of the PNP collector current by gate, and thus it generates it breaking the regenerative feedback effect. So here you can see the symbol of the GTO. So symbol is similar to that of SCR, but if you focus on this part, that is the gate part, you can clearly see there are two arrows over there. The arrow which is going to the cathode and which is coming from the cathode. So this is the difference between the symbol of the SCR and the GTO. In GTO, there is only one arrow, that is inward side arrow, it is given. That means we can only make the SCR on, we cannot turn it off. So in the GTOs, what is happening? The two arrows are representing that we are making the SCR on as well as we are making the SCR off. So here we can see the PNPN structure over here. This is anode, this is cathode. There are three junctions, junction 1, 2, 3 are there. So in these junctions, what we can see, we have to break the regenerative feedback effect over here so that we have to make the anode current minimum. So what is the important consideration of the GTO is, it should be made in such a way that the PNP current gain of the GTO is reduced. So how we are going to reduce the regenerative feedback action? For reducing the regenerative feedback action of the GTO, we have to reduce the current gain of the PNP transistors. So when we are going to decrease the current gain of the PNP transistor, the current gain of NPN is automatically will get reduced, thereby reducing the regenerative feedback effect. So highly doped N spots in the anode and the P layer of the shorted emitter terminal effect is ultimately decreases the current gain of the GTO for lower current regeneration, and it also having the reverse voltage blocking capability. So because the GTO does not require any external commutation circuit to make it off, so it is having the reverse voltage blocking capability. So because of this, this reduction in the reverse blocking capability can be improved by diffusing gold, but this reduces the carrier lifetime. So here, this is giving us the GTO characteristics, that is turning on and the turning off characteristics of the GTO over here. So these two graphs are giving us the turn on and the turn off time of the GTO. So what we can see here, the first graph we can see that is related to the anode voltage, and the second graph is related to the IG, that is gate current. Now here we have to focus on the gate current only, because the conduction of the GTO, that is turning on process of the GTO and turning off process of the GTO, is totally depending upon the IG, that is gate current. So here the two graphs are mainly related with the anode voltage and anode current, and the second graph is related to the gate current. So let us see with respect to time, how does it vary. So in this is VA, that is the maximum VA, and when the VA is decreased, the IA increased over here. So you can see over here, there is a sudden voltage drop in the anode voltage, there is sudden rise in the anode current. So this rise in the anode current is depending upon the rise of this IG, that is IGP, gate current. So when the gate current increases, anode current increases, and there is decrease in the anode voltage. Now what is happening here? At this point, the anode current is constant. So this time the anode current is constant. Now this state is showing us the latching current. Your SCR is latched, it is held in the latching state. So here the anode current is constant over here, and this is called as on state voltage drop. So on state voltage drop means the anode current is flowing, SCR it is in the conduction state, but still there is a drop in the voltage, that is called as on state voltage drop. Now in this portion the SCR it is in the latching state. Now if suppose we have to make the SCR off, what is happening? We are giving the gate pulse, because we are talking about the GTOs over here, that is gate turn of thyristor. So what we have to do is we have to remove the gate supply. So after removing the gate supply, what is happening? This gate current is now, see, it is negatively increased. We can say this is reverse blocking voltage. This is negatively increased, and again it reaches to the initial value. So what is happening here? The anode current is also decreased. So anode current is decreased, and this is called as tail current. So when again the gate current from negative value, when it goes to the initial value, your anode current is reaching to the minimum value over here. So here what you can say, this is related to the gate current and the anode voltage and anode current. So this gate current is responsible for varying this anode current. In the case of GTOs only I am talking about. So here if the anode current is decreasing from this value to the this value, this is called as tail current. So this tail current is nothing but the, it is the value which is depending upon the gate current. When the gate current is increased from negative value to the initial value, and here that current is called as a tail current. Now here this VA is equal to VS. VA is the anode voltage over here. So these are the characteristics, turn on and the turn off characteristics are related with the GTO, where we can see that how the GTO is can be turned on and turn off by itself only. It does not require any commutation circuit like in the SCRs. So here we have seen about the SCR, its characteristics, and GTOs over here. So this is all about the GTO and the SCR. Thank you.